Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to welcome all of you to this interesting course. And also, I would like to thank you very much for participating in this video conference. I would like to start this video conference sharing with you this quote. Tell me and I'll forget. Show me and I may remember. Involve me and I learn. I like to share this quote with my students because I think that it is very true. We have to involve our students in order for them to learn. If we just show them how to do things, maybe they are not going to be able to perform what we are teaching them. So for this reason, I always like to share this quote with my students. I also like to tell you that it is very important to consider this quote when assessing your students, because if you involve your students in learning, then they are going to be able to perform in the best way while you are assessing them. Well, now it is time to talk about the course. You all may read some information about this interesting course, but I would like to share with you this. This course is going to be very helpful for you and is going to help you in order to provide with the best tools and also to provide you with the principles of language assessment, techniques. Also, you are going to be able to remember and also to know different tasks and different alternatives that are going to be very necessary in order to assess your students, in order to assess English learners. In relation to this course, you know that now you are studying the third semester. This course is a 4-credit course. For this reason, you are going to study 128 hours during this course. I would like to share with you the number of hours that you are going to study in an autonomous way. 12 hours a week you are going to dedicate alone in order to pass this course. Then 4 hours a week are going to be dedicated to this course, are going to be dedicated to the study of classroom language assessment with your professor. Remember that we are going to be involved in different activities, for example, chats, video conferences. You are going to work also in a forum. In this case, you are going to work with me. I would also like to share with you the different activities that we are going to be involved. All of you know that we are going to work with chats, video. We already had our first chat this Tuesday, and I think that it was really productive. I would also like to thank all of the participants that share with the whole course their opinions, their concerns, and also their questions related to the topic that we studied last Tuesday. You already have the schedule of activities that we are going to complete and that we are going to be working with during these 8 weeks. This week we started with chat number 1. Next week we are going to continue working with video number 1. It is going to be developed on Tuesday, October 18. I already sent you some information related to the video conference. It is going to be about the use of portfolios in order to enhance students' participation and also in order to develop our students or to improve our students' learning. Then, on week number 4, we are going to continue working with chat number 2. It is going to be developed on Tuesday, October 25th. And also, I would like to share with you that the time in which we are going to meet for these chats and also for these video conferences is from 6 p.m. until 7 p.m. and from 7 p.m. until 8 p.m. Please be aware that I am going to be sending you all the information that you need in order to be prepared for these chats and video conferences. It is also important to share with you that chat number two will be developed, video number two will be developed on Tuesday, November 1st. We are going to have to be working on this video. Chat number three will be developed on Tuesday, November 8th, and video conference number three will be developed, will be carried out on Tuesday, November 15th. Regarding the academic forum, all of you know that in each one of the courses, you have to participate in an academic forum. This academic forum is already available on EVA, so you can participate on the forum from October 13, that is today, until October 20. Wiki is also one of the activities that you have to complete. In the wiki corresponding to classroom language assessment will be available from November 14 until November 17. Of course, today I am not going to provide you with information about the wiki and information or topics related to our next chats and video conferences, but just I am providing you with the date and also the time that we are going to meet. Then I am going to share with you the topics that we are going to study during each one of these online activities. Regarding the essay part of your distance assignment, today I would like to share with you the four assignments that you have to complete. The first assignment that you were working with was developed this week. This assignment was divided.
Hello.
This assignment. Okay, everyone, now we are going to continue. I was talking about the assignments, the essay part that you have to complete during this course. As you know, 4 essay assignments have been designed for you to complete, and they are related to the contents that we are going to study during this course. As I told you, the first essay assignment was related to formative and summative assessment. And I know that some of you have already finished this activity, and also you are continue working on this activity. But I consider necessary to talk about this activity. Essay assignment 1 was divided into 2 activities. The first activity, you had to write in your own words a 300-word essay based on the following question. What is the difference between formative and summative assessment, okay? And I also provided you with information about the considerations that you have to have in order to write this essay. You have also to analyze additional information in books or journals, at least 2 sources. I provided you with this information because it is necessary to provide your own information, to provide your own words in this essay, but it is also necessary to provide 2 different sources in order to support your ideas. In relation to activity 1.2, I ask you to look for some of the tasks or assignments you have used or you have designed that are formative in nature. So then you have to choose just 1 of these tasks or assignments, and after that, after this analysis, you have to write in your own words a 100-word essay. In this essay, you have to explain the reasons for applying that type of assessment with your students. In addition, you have to explain why the task you selected is formative in nature. I ask you to do this because it is really important for you as teachers to be aware of formative and summative assessment, and also to be aware of the way in which you are assessing your students. Because if you assess your students considering summative types of assessments, they are not going to be able to be involved in interactive activities, and also to be involved in activities that are going to help them to increase their knowledge. Regarding essay assignment number 2, you have to write in your own words a 400-word essay in which you clearly describe why a test you have designed applies the 5 principles of language testing or assessment. Remember that in our first chat, we talked about or we studied about the 5 principles of language assessment, and I am happy to know that almost all of you have heard about these 5 principles of language assessment, and also I am happy to know that you are applying these 5 principles of language assessments in your tests and also in your activities. But it is necessary to work on this topic. It is necessary that you work on this essay in order to reflect on the way you are designing your language tests. It is also important to consider that you have to look for 2 sources, at least 2 sources, in order to support your ideas. First, I suggest you to analyze all of the possible tests that you have applied with your students, and then you have just to select 1 of those tests, and after that you have to reflect on the way you have designed this test. Regarding essay assignment number 3, I have asked here to work on a test specification format. We are going to learn in this course about test specifications. It is something, or this topic is not new, but not all of the teachers used to work with test specifications. For this reason, this topic was considered for you to work on an essay, on the essay part. I provided you with the format here. You can review the format, and you can review each one of the aspects that you have to complete. The test specification format begins with a general description of the test that you are going to apply with your students. I would like to share with you some information. Of course, you have this information in your textbook, but this video conference is the appropriate opportunity to share this information, okay? In the general description, you have to provide a brief general description of the behavior to be tested and also the purpose of testing the skills you selected. If you selected, for example, listening or speaking to be assessing your test, you have to provide a description. You have to provide the purpose for assessing listening and speaking. If you consider that you are going to assess listening, speaking, reading, and writing, also in the general description, you have to include the purpose for assessing these four skills. Regarding prompt attributes, in this part, you have to provide a complete and detailed description of the material that will be included in the test, okay? In this part, prompt attributes, you are going to provide a description of the material that you are going to include in the test. You have to include also information about the score, about the way in which you are going to score each one of the activities, and the type and number of items. In one of the units that we are going to study, you have been provided with different types of tasks or items. And in this part, prompt attributes, you are going to include all this information. Which types of tasks and items are going to be included here? For example, if you are going to assess listening, speaking, reading, and writing, what you have to do is to include, for example, the type of tasks that are going to be used in order to assess listening. If you think that information transfer is a good task to assess listening, so you have to include here this part. Information transfer is going to be used to assess listening. In speaking, maybe you are going to use short answer responses. This is a type of task. You are going to use short answer response in order to assess speaking and also the way in which you are going to score this activity. Regarding response attributes, in this part, you have to provide a complete and detailed description in which the answer will be provided. In this case, what you have to do is to write this description in which the answer will be provided. In this part, you involve your students. What would you like your students from your students? What is their response, or what is going to be your student's response? Okay? What the student will do in their response? What would you like from your student? Or it is the same as the type of response the student will perform. Okay, in this part, response attributes, we are going to deal here with your students' responses, the way in which they are going to respond, okay? And also the criteria for evaluating. If you are going to use here an essay part, so you have to include the criteria for evaluating. Regarding sample items, in this part, you are going to provide the tasks and also an example of the task that you are going to use in order to design your test, okay? The sample items. For example, you are going to assess listening, speaking, reading, and writing. In this case, in this part, you are not going to say just we are going, or I am going to use information transfer, multiple choice items, but in this part, you have to provide an example. If you are going to use multiple choice items, you have to provide an example here. You have to provide the question, if it is a question, and also the options that your students may encounter when they are taking the test. Regarding specification supplements, in this part, you have to include a detailed explanation of any additional information to construct items. For example, in grammar, you have to include the precise grammar form that is going to be tested. In relation to reading, you have to provide a list of the books that you are going to use, from which you are going to take some reading passages, okay? In these specification supplements, you are not going to provide any item or any task, but you are going to provide here the materials that you use in order to design your test. As I told you, for example, for reading, you are going to use a book. You have to include here information of the book, okay? To design this test, I am going to use this book. I am going to take some test passages, for example, and here you have to include all of the material that you are going to use in order to design your test. Maybe it is going to be something new for you, so I think that maybe this task is going to be a little hard for you, but not difficult, not impossible to complete. So if you have questions related to this assignment, please feel free of contacting me. You can send me some mails, you can call me, and if you are here in Loja, you can come to my office in order to explain the way in which you have to complete this activity. You are going to see that it is not difficult. Maybe it is something new. For this reason, you may think that it is going to be difficult, but it is not difficult. I am sure that this test specification format and also the completion of this task is going to be very useful for you, because in the future you are going to be able to design better tests because you have this format, you have this outline. Remember that test specification is like the outline of your test, and it is going to guide you in the best way to design the test. Regarding essay assignment number 4, it is a nice assignment also for you, because this is related to the use of portfolios. The use of portfolios is not so common today, but it is really nice and really helpful for you and also for your students. In this assignment, what you have to do is to write a 300-word essay in which you have to explain how useful the implementation of portfolio was in your students' progress. Remember that portfolio is a type of alternative in assessment that is very useful to help your student to progress in the learning process. Also, you have to include information about the strategies you use to assess the portfolio, and use information from books or journals, as I also have mentioned before. At least 2 sources in order to support your essay. Here, in this essay, you are going to talk about your experience, you are going to explain about the usefulness of the implementation of this portfolio, but also, it is necessary to support your ideas with at least 2 sources or 2 authors that talk about portfolios. I also would like to share with you that this is the last activity. You are going to send this activity the 7 weeks of studies, but it is very necessary that you start working on this assignment. I have provided you with information in the guide, and also I have sent you information on EVA, in which I ask you to select one of your students and start working in the implementation of portfolio. Just one student, because it is going to be, if you were not accustomed to work with portfolios, it is going to be difficult for you to implement this type of assessment with all of your students. For this reason, I have asked you to choose just one of your students and start working on the portfolio. So you have to work with this activity, and at the end, you have to analyze how useful the implementation of this portfolio was. Okay, so I think that you already started with this activity, and you have already collected some of your students' materials, okay? But if you didn't have the opportunity to do this, it is the moment to start working, because if you don't have the material, at the end it is going to be difficult for you to complete this assignment. In relation to the schedule of activities, I have also provided you with this information on EVA, but it is always useful to share with you this information through this video conference, okay? Essay assignment one, tomorrow is the due date. Remember, today is October 13, and tomorrow, October 14, is the due date for you to send this assignment one, okay? The link is not created. The link is already created, so you have to go to EVA and use this link in order to send this first assignment. In relation to essay assignment number two, the due date to send this assignment is October 28th. Assignment number three is going to be sent on November 4th. And assignment number four, the last assignment, is going to be sent on November 14. Okay, so this information is already provided on EVA, but it is also useful to share with you today. Important dates that I consider to share with you today is the due date for sending your distance evaluation, okay? Be aware that from November 15 until November 17, you are going to be able, or you have to send this distance evaluation through EVA. So you have to enter in EVA as you have done with the other courses, and you have to send the objective part and also the essay part. On November 26th and 27th, you are going to be taking the on-site evaluation. As you know, the resources that you are using, the main resources that you are using in this course are the book, the basic book, Practical Language Testing. All of you, I think that already have this book. Also, the textbook, Language Assessment, Principles and Classroom Practices. This book is also really useful, is going to be really useful for you, because it provides you with useful information. It provides you with many examples of different tasks that you can use in order to assess your students, and also your didactic guide, Classroom Language Assessment, in which you will find many resources to assess your progress. You have some further readings that are suggested. You have some additional activities in order to assess your progress, and the self-assessments at the end of each one of the units. Now it is time to share with you each one of the units that are going to be covered during this course, okay? As you already know, we are going to cover 6 units, and they are very important and useful because they contain useful topics and also very practical activities, okay? As you already know, in Unit 1, we are going to study testing and assessment in context. In this unit, we are going to study about the test purpose, about tests in educational systems, about unintended consequences of assessment, of assessing students, and principles of language assessment, okay? This is unit number one. We are going to start with the test purpose, as you already know. And the last topic is principles of language assessment, okay? I have also a quote here that is related to testing and assessment, and I would like to share with you, if the purpose for learning is to score well on a test, we have lost sight of the real reason for learning. So this is a quote that has to do with students. If you read this quote, you will be able to reflect on your teaching, okay? So we don't have to prepare our students or to force our students to score well on a test, but to learn and also to apply what they have learned, okay? To develop their competences. I would like to talk about principles of language assessment, as we have already studied, as we have already talked in our first chat, practicality, reliability, validity, authenticity, and watchback are the five principles of language assessment. I would like also to share with you that these principles are not going to be used to apply in formal tests. Remember that also we have informal tests, informal way of assessing students, and these principles of language assessment can be used also in formal and informal tests. As we already talked, for our test to be practical, it should be completed within appropriate time constraints. We have already discussed about this. The test has not to be too long for students. It doesn't have to take too much time for our students to take. Also, if a test is taken in a few minutes, it is not going to be practical. Maybe it is too easy, so it is not going to be practical. Directions should be clear, and also we have to properly use available human and material resources. If we don't have maybe a computer, if we don't have a CD player, it is going to be very difficult to apply a listening test here. So in this case, we have to be aware of the materials or resources that we have available in order to design our test. In relation to reliability, we already talked that if a test is reliable, the results from our test takers are going to be similar, even if they take the test in two different times, okay? In two different occasions. Also about items or tasks, we have to be clear here that items or tasks have to be unambiguous. In this case, they have to be very clear for students to understand what they have to do. Directions for scoring also have to be clear. Regarding validity, we already talked about this. We have to consider all the content that we have studied in order to be included in the test. For example, we studied 4 units. We didn't time to cover unit number 5. It is not possible to include content from unit number 5 in our test because our students are not familiar. They don't know the content of unit number 5, okay? If we include the content of these 5 units, our test is not valid because our students don't know the content. And they don't have the time, maybe they are not going to have the time to study the content by themselves. So it is not going to be fair to include this content. It doesn't measure irrelevant variables, okay? If we are going to assess our students' speaking skills, so it is not possible to include here some information about reading because I don't want to test reading abilities but speaking abilities. Also, for a test to be valid, it has to involve performance that samples the test criterion or objectives. In this case, we have to consider the objective of the course, or we have to consider the objective of the lesson in order to design the test. What about authenticity? We already talked about this. For a test to be authentic, we have to provide some kind of context in the test, in each one of the tasks, for our students to have a better understanding of the whole idea of the whole sentence or of the whole paragraph, in order to provide a response or in order to select any choice. The language has to be as natural as possible. Topics have to be relevant, meaningful, and interesting, and tasks have to replicate real-world tasks. As we already shared, in this case, we have to provide students with information, or we have to provide students with tasks that can be replicated in real-world tasks. They are going to be able to use this language in a real situation or in a real context. It is not possible to provide them with a language that is not interesting for them, a language that is not relevant for them, because they are not going to use this kind of language in a real situation. Regarding washback, we have to remember that washback is going to be useful to give learner feedback that enhances their language development. We are going to help our students in their progress. We are going to help our students to improve their learning, and washback is the best opportunity for us to provide our students with that opportunity. Washback is provided when the test provides students with adequate or proper feedback, okay? A test that provides beneficial washback is more formative than summative. We have to be aware of this. We are going to help our students to improve their learning, to progress, and washback is going to offer them this opportunity. Also, they are going to be provided with opportunities to adequately prepare. We are going to use tasks, we are going to use activities in which they can show their abilities. For this reason, washback is important. This is something about unit number one. Of course, we have some other topics, and we are going to talk about them maybe by phone, if you think that you need additional support on these topics. Now it is time to continue with unit number two. Classroom assessment is the topic of unit number two. Classroom assessment, we are English teachers, so we have to analyze information about how to assess our students' learning. In this case, we have five topics: assessment for learning, test, tasks, or items, alternatives in assessment, dynamic assessment, and portfolio assessment. As I already talked to you, in this unit, we are going to focus on test, tasks, or items. Of course, we have in this unit many different important topics, and it is really useful for you to analyze all of this information and also to reflect on your teaching practice. For example, here we have alternatives in assessment. You have to be aware that for assessing our students' learning, we don't have just the help of formal tests, okay? We are not going to assess our students at the end of the unit or at the end of the course, but we have many different materials, many different alternatives in which we can assess our students. For example, you have some conferences, you have the use of portfolios. Also, you can use self-assessment in order to, as an alternative to assess your students. We don't have to count on formal tests, but we have different alternatives that can be used in order to help our students. Through these alternatives, we are going to be able to know if our students are learning, are progressing during the course. Regarding test tasks or items, the most common tasks or items that we as teachers use are multiple choice items, yes, no, and true, false items. Excuse me. Also, short answer items are used. They are the most common used by teachers, but of course we have some other tasks or items that are useful for students in order to interact with the language, in order to interact with their classmates. Remember that tasks or items are not used just at the end in formal tests. You can use all of these items in your classes, in every one of your lessons. Remember that we are not going to teach in every lesson without assessing our student. We are teaching and at the same time we can assess our students, okay? Here we have this picture cute task, okay? Picture cute task. In this task, test takers are provided with a picture, as you can observe there, with a picture cute stimulus, and they have to describe what they see. In this case, it depends on the skill that you would like to assess. You provide your students with this picture cute task, with this picture cute stimulus, and then you ask them to describe what they see. Maybe you are going to ask them to describe this in an oral way, or if you think that it is better for them to read, you provide them this picture cute stimulus, they have to read some words, they have to analyze each one of the pictures, and after that, they have to provide a written response. In this case, you are going to integrate skills. You are going to ask your students to read, and also they are going to be asked to write a response. As you can see here, you are integrating skills. Also, you can ask them to talk, to describe this picture, so speaking is going to be assessed in this case. What about this sentence dialogue completion task? Of course, I think that you have used this task. In this case, we provide our students, or we provide test takers, with this little strip of paper, and then they have to assemble this into a story. So they have to read the information that they are provided, and after that, they have to complete these sentences or dialogues. And it is really important because you will be able to know if they understand what they read in this story. Then we have ordering tasks. In this case, you can ask your student to maybe unscramble some sentences, some words here, or you are going to provide your students with different sentences or dialogues, and they have to complete the lines. In this case, they have to reorder. This is an ordering task. So what they have to do is to read each one of the sentences, and then they have to reorder the task in order to create a sentence or in order to create a story. Yeah, this is about unit number 2, okay? I would like that you review, that you analyze information about portfolio assessment, also alternatives in assessment, because the use of portfolio or portfolio is an important alternative for assessing your students. Regarding unit 3, deciding what to test. In this part, we are going to review about the test design cycle. Remember that for applying a test or for designing a test, it is not just to open our textbooks and to start using some sentences or some information to assess our students. What we have to do first is to consider the purpose, okay? For this reason here, you are provided with the test design cycle, then you are going to review about models of communicative competence, and also it is important to talk about construct and performance models. Okay, all of this information is really important for you to design a test. It is not that easy to go to your textbook and start designing your test. We have to consider the test design cycle, and for classroom language assessment, these four steps have to be considered. First of all, we have the test purpose, then the test criterion, construct definition, and then task item design, specification writing. As you can see here, first of all, we have to consider the purpose for assessing. Now, what about the test purpose? As I told you, before selecting the test content and format, we have to be clear of the purpose for testing. Okay, so we have to establish our purpose for testing. Once we know our purpose for testing, we can select the test content and also the format that we are going to use. Okay, I know my purpose, and then I can decide if I am going to use some items in order to assess listening skills, to use some items in order to assess maybe speaking skills, and this is going to help me to decide on the format that I am going to use. For example, if we talk about achievement, if we are going to assess our learners or our students' achievement, what we have to consider here? The course content, okay? So we have to consider the course content and information of the course content that we have provided, that our students have studied, has to be included in the test. If we talk about proficiency tests, we have to be aware that our test takers are going to be assessed in a global way, okay? Proficiency tests are used to test global competence in a language. We are going to assess overall ability because this is a proficiency test. But because we are working with students, we are talking about classroom language assessment, we have, or our purpose is to know our students' achievement. For this reason, we are going to consider course content, then we are going to decide on the format and type of items that are going to be used to design the test. In relation to the test criterion, we have to consider here that the test criterion is related or refers to our objectives. In classroom language assessment, we have our unit plans, we have lesson plans, we have the objectives for the whole course, objective for the unit, objectives for the lesson. These are the objectives that we have to consider in order to design the test, okay? According to Hambleton, 1994, the test criterion is the intended outcome of instruction or objective, okay? The test criterion, first or after we consider the purpose for our test, for designing our test, we have to be aware of these test criterion, which are the objectives of my course. Test criterion has to be clearly stated and identified. If I don't know, or if I forgot the objectives of my course, so it is going to be really difficult for me as a teacher to design the test, because I have the content, okay? I have many different items, I have many different tasks that can be used to design my test, but I am not aware of the objective. So it is something really important, okay? You have to go, you have to use your book, but you have to read also, you have to analyze again your unit plan, your objectives, in order to design your test. Now it is important to talk about constructs, okay? Construct definition. It is really important to be aware of this, okay? Here we have some well-known authors that have described construct definition in a clear way, okay? What if we talk about, or if we review what McNamara says about the test construct, okay? What are test constructs? They are those aspects of knowledge, okay? Be aware of this. Constructs are aspects of knowledge or skill possessed by the candidate, by the student, by the test taker, which are being measured, okay? Then we have another definition. A construct is any theory, hypothesis, or model that attempts to explain observed phenomena in our universe or perceptions, okay? Remember that. A construct is the aspect of knowledge or skill that our candidate has, okay? Now, please review these examples. Examples of linguistic construct, proficiency, okay? We are going to measure our students' proficiency, or we are going to measure communicative competence. These are constructs of, these are linguistic constructs. If we talk about fluency, remember that if we would like to know how fluent a student or how fluent a candidate is in the use of English language, so we have to design a test in which the speaking skills are going to be assessed. So this is the construct, okay? Remember that first we have to consider purpose, after that the criterion or objective, but also it is really important to be aware of these constructs of the English language. Of course, here in classroom language assessment, we are going to be dealing with proficiency, communicative competence, and fluency. And remember that right now, we are using the communicative language teaching approach. So if we read a little bit more about communicative language teaching approach, we are going to be able to know that there are many tasks, there are many materials, there are many strategies and activities that can be used in order to measure or in order to assess our students' communicative competence. So you have to be aware of this. We are going to be dealing with proficiency, communicative competence, and fluency. These are the constructs that we are going to consider. About psychological constructs, we have self-esteem and also motivation, okay? You have to be aware of this also. If you would like to measure your student's motivation, or if you would like to know about your student's motivation, so you have to be aware maybe of the materials that you are using. But it is going to be something different. You are not going to assess your student proficiency, fluency, or communicative competence, but you would like to know how motivated your students are in your classroom. So you are going to consider these constructs. You are going to be aware of your students' reactions. You are going to be aware of your student participation, if they react different, if you use different material, you are not going to assess this, or you are not going to measure this in order to assign a grade, but to know if the materials that you are using, or to know if your attitude is motivating your students. What about this step? Task item design, specification writing. Remember that we have been talking about tasks or items. It is also really important in the test design cycle. We have purpose, criterion, constructs, and also task items design. Okay? In this, we have to consider that item specifications describe the prompts or materials that we are going to use in order to elicit evidence, okay? To make inferences about test takers' ability. Our task item design, in this step, we have to provide information about the materials that we are going to use in order to get some response, in order to get some evidence from our students. Then we will be able to make some inferences about our students' abilities, if they are good, or maybe if they have to work a little bit more. So in this case, we have to adapt our teaching for our students to improve their learning. Then, item specifications state the input material, a sample of instructions, and sample items that test takers will encounter in the test. What do we mean with this? Item specifications state the input material. The input material, okay? The material that we are going to provide our students in order to get a response. Which material I am going to use, okay? The sample of instructions in this part or in this step. Also, I as a teacher have to be clear about the instructions that I am going to provide. So a sample of these instructions have to be provided in this part of task item design. Also, some sample items have to be included. Remember that we are going to work on an outline of our test. This is not my test. This is not the test that I am going to apply to my students, but this is an important document for me to know what I am going to do, to know what I am going to use in order to design the test. So a sample sample items or sample tasks have to be included here. In this case, I know what I am going to include in the test, what my students are going to encounter in the test. Yeah, this is all about unit number 3. Now we are going to continue with the information about unit number 4. We talked a little bit about test specifications. Now in unit number 4, we are going to find more information about the way in which we have to design test specifications. This unit is designing test specifications, and the topics that we are going to cover here are: what are test specifications, specifications for testing and teaching, and also performance conditions. Okay, remember that test specifications are like our outline, okay, the outline of our test, and it is going to help me to design the test, and it is going to be easier to design the test, to assign the score, to design of the type of items to be used in the test, okay? Regarding this designing test specifications, we have to consider that there are some steps, there are some possible aspects in order to design this outline. First of all, we have to consider item type, item task specifications, okay? Item task specifications. Here, as I already shared with you, we have to include information about the input material that you are going to provide to your students, some instructions. They are just sample of the instructions that you are going to provide your students in the test. Also the sample items that you will provide your students in the test, okay? Then, regarding evidence specification, when we talk about evidence specifications or evidence, we talk about the response that our student or that our candidates are going to provide in the test, okay? This type of specifications describe what test takers are expected to do, okay? What do I want from my students? What do I want from the candidates, okay? What are the types of responses that I expect from them? Also, you have to be aware of something here. For subjective tasks or essay assignments, we have to use rubrics, and also we have to use some criteria in order to score this type of assignments. In evidence specifications, we also deal with the use of some objective tasks, multiple choice tasks. We can use, for example, true or false. We can use yes or no questions. In this case, we are going to have just one choice that is going to be correct. So in this case, it is not necessary to use rubrics because we have just the key in order to grade this type of task. Regarding test assembly specification, be aware of this. What is test assembly specification? Here we are going to show the number of item types that will be included in the test. Remember that in item task specifications, we provide information about the instructions, about tasks that we are going to use, but here in the test assembly specification, we are going to provide the number of item types that we are going to use. Maybe I am going to use 4 multiple choice items to assess listening. I am going to use 3 short answer questions to assess speaking. So I have to be specific with this, how many type of items I am going to use. So it is not like writing, I am going to use 20 items, or I am going to use 40 items to assess my students' progress. No, I have to be very specific here. 4 items, 4 multiple choice items for assessing listening, 2 short answer items or tasks to assess listening. I am going to use 5 picture cue tasks to assess reading. So you have to be very specific with this part. Also, it shows that the number and range of items represent the key features of the criteria. In this case, remember that we were talking about objectives. So in this part, I have to include information about this. The number of items and the variety of items that I am using in my test represent the features of my criterion. Okay, they are very related to the objectives for the lesson, the objectives of the course that I am teaching. Well, in relation to presentation specification, okay, in relation to this aspect, we have to consider that in this part we have to show the, how the items and support materials will be presented to our candidates. The way in which my test, the way in which items and support material will be presented, okay? For example, in this case, margin size, font type and size, spacing, all of these things, all of these aspects are going to be included in this presentation specification. Maybe you think that it is not something too important, but we have to be very clear with the way in which we are going to present the test to our students. So it is something, it is also an important aspect when designing your test specifications. Now, about delivery specification. In this delivery specification, the details of the test administration are presented, okay? Here we have some details, how the test is going to be conducted, or how to the test is going to be provided to my student, or the environment for the test administration. In this case, we have to consider timing in this case, okay? Spacing between desks or computers, if we are going to take a computer-based assessed, okay, or test. In this case, timing, how much time is it going to test, okay? The space between my desks, maybe my students are too close, so I have to consider this. I am going to ask them to be not too close, so in this delivery specification, we have to consider this, the space between my students' desks. Also, the number of test takers, so I have 20 students, so I have to consider this. I am going to to apply this test to 20 students, 25 students, so it is also important, okay? In materials that will be allowed to use during the administration. Maybe I think that it is important for my students to use the dictionary, so in this delivery specification, I have to include this. Students need, or students will be able to use the dictionary because, so I have to give the reasons, because my students are going to be allowed to use the dictionary, or any other material, maybe they are going to bring their computers, I am going to allow my students to use computers, to use tablets because of the nature of the test. So you have to include all of this information in this delivery specification. Then we arrive required to unit number 5. It is aligning test to standard. It is also an important unit, and the topics that we are going to cover here are the definition and uses of standards, unintended consequences revisited, using standards for harmonization and identity, and the common European framework of reference. Okay? Remember that right now we are working with the National English Curriculum Guidelines. We have to consider that in this document we review, or we have some information about these different levels of proficiency. We already have working with this common European framework or of reference. So we as English teachers have to analyze that document, and we have to consider all the performance levels, and from that we have to work on our plans, and also we have to work on the design of different activities and also on the design of our English tests. For this reason, this information was considered. Also, you are aware, you have been working with this document, and it is important to review information about this common European framework of reference. Okay, I am going to upload this document on EVA because it provides useful information, and also you are going to be able to reflect on your own teaching, and also you're going to be able to reflect on the different proficiency levels that our students have to reach, the different performance levels that they have to develop. Okay? In this document, the Common European Framework, you are going to find that it describes in a comprehensive way what language learners have to learn to do. Okay? Here you are going to find all of these reference levels and the way in which you can work with your students for them to develop their skills. Also defines levels of proficiency which allow learners' progress to be measured, as I already shared with you. Okay, you're going to find these proficiency levels, you are going to find many different activities that can be used for your students to develop their competences. In relation to Unit 6, we are going to review information about testing and teaching. We are going to concentrate here on WASHBAC, preparing learners for tests, and also selecting and using tests. In this case, remember that we talked about WASHBAC previously, and also we talked about the design of the test, but we didn't talk about how to prepare our learners for tests. We have to be aware that we don't have to prepare our learners to take the test and to score well on the test, because maybe they are going to score well on the test, but tomorrow or next week they are not going to be able to put into practice what they learned in the class or what we intended to them to learn. For this reason, it is very necessary that for preparing our students for tests, we have to consider two types of preparation, and we have to decide which type of preparation to use. One of these types of preparation is to familiarize learners with the test. How we are going to do this, okay? We are going to provide our students with some item types. We are not going to tell them what we're going to use or the way in which they are going to be tested, but we can use different type of tasks in the class during the lesson, and we are going to prepare our students, we are going to let our students to be familiar with the type of items that we are going to use. For example, if we use picture cute tasks in a test, we can also use picture cute tasks in our lessons, in every lesson or every activity, not just to score their performance, but for providing them with opportunities to participate, to be in contact with the language, to interact in the class, and at the same time, when they are participating, we can assess their progress. Something important also is to consider kind of instructions, okay? The kind of instructions that our students are going to encounter in the test. Maybe I am going to write on the board some instructions for them to participate, some instructions for an activity to be developed inside the classroom. So in this case, we are preparing our students for the test, but in a way that they participate, in a way that they can improve their language skills, in a way that they can use the language inside the classroom. We are not preparing just for the test, but at the same time, we are working with them in different activities. Then practice in working within time constraints. In this case, we are going to provide our students, not with a test, but with an activity, and also we are going to set some specific time. We are not going to tell them, okay, you are going to find something similar in your test, so you have to complete this in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Be aware that you are going to do the same in a test. No, you have to do this in a way that it is an activity for your students inside the classroom, but you know that at the same time you are preparing your students for the test. For example, if you realize that an activity takes too much time to your students, what you have to do is to adapt this activity and also to adapt the item in your test. For your students not to take too much time when they have to take the test, okay? This is important to consider, and this is information about the first type of preparation. Now please let's review information about the second type of preparation, and this is important to increase the score of test takers, okay? The second type is related to the way in which teachers work to help students to increase the scores, their scores, okay? In this type of preparation, test-taking techniques that focus on test items are going to be shared with our students, okay? We are going to prepare them, we are going to tell them, for example, concentrate on the longest option, because sometimes or because many times it is the correct option. Or we ask them to focus on the longest option to see if it is the correct response. Another aspect that sometimes is shared with students, or that we show our students or practice with our students in classes, is to help them match lexical items, or to show them how to match lexical items in the stem to synonyms in the key. So we are not preparing them for using the language in real situation, for understanding the language or to improve their knowledge or learning, but we are preparing them to improve their scores. We are preparing them on how to work with each one of the items, and it is not something good, because we are English teachers and we are working with our students in the class. We are teaching English as a foreign language, and we would like is that our students use the language to communicate. So in this case, we have to provide our students with opportunities to practice the language, and at the same time to prepare them to take the test, to be familiar with the test, but at the same time to work, not just to concentrate on the test, to take the test. Okay, this is all the information that I decided to share with you today because of the time. We have just 1 hour to share information about the different units that are going to be studied during this course. Because we have just 1 hour, it is not possible to continue talking about some other topics, but remember that you can contact me to talk about the different topics, to talk about your teaching experience, if you have any question, if you find that something is not clear, you can call me. I am going to provide you with this information, with information about tutorials on EVA, but today I am going to share with you that our tutorial day is Friday, tomorrow is Friday, so you can call me tomorrow from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. and I am going to provide you the phone number and also the extension number in which you can contact me, okay? I am going to provide also this PowerPoint presentation on EVA so you can review the information and also information about tutorials. Yeah, okay, now we are going to have half an hour for some questions. If you have some questions, please feel free to ask them because we have this time assigned in order to talk about the subject, in order to talk about maybe assignments or any other question that you would like to ask. Thank you very much, everyone. I have been told that there is no question, any question today, but as I told you before, if you have any questions related to the course, please feel free of contacting me each one of the weeks that we are going to study during this course. Thank you very much for your participation. Remember that tomorrow we have our first tutorials from 3 to 5. So if you have any questions, please call me, send me a message, or if you are here in Loja, please come to my office, that I am here to help you. Thank you very much and have a nice day.